Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Good morning, everyone. It's my pleasure to introduce Oliver Cossart. He graduated a PhD from Columbia University, and now he's with Northwestern, where he founded the Computational Photography Lab. Oliver's an expert in computational imaging, and he's going to be talking about some of his projects today.
Great. Thanks, Yingbin. Okay. First of all, it's great to be here. Thanks, Yingbin, for inviting me. And basically, what I had in mind for this talk today is to just give you a bit of a flavor for the different type of projects that we work in my group. I've been at Northwestern now for about 3 years, just starting now to build up my group. And we're interested in basically anything where we get to play around with actual optical instrumentation, so like building cameras, building imaging systems, and also get our hands dirty in terms of developing both the algorithms and the instrument itself, whether that means actually playing around with the optical side of things or the sensing hardware or any combination of these things. And broadly, we're interested in applications that span anything in the field of optical imaging, anything in the field of computer vision related applications, or overlaps between that and image processing and computer graphics. So that's basically a high-level idea of the interests and the motivation of my research group. And what I'm going to talk to you about today is essentially three different projects that sort of give a flavor of the kind of things that we do and the kind of things that we're interested in. And also give you a sense of sort of the diversity of the type of work that we do and want to do. Basically, various levels of technical novelty. So the first one that I'll talk about is this motion contrast 3D scanner that we've developed, which is essentially what we think is a very light efficient, power usage efficient way to do active 3D scanning. And I'll tell you about that, and I'll give you some technical details about that. And then I'm going to talk for a while about these surface shape studies, which is of some very famous artworks that are housed at the Art Institute of Chicago. And so we do some collaborations with cultural heritage imaging, things like the Art Institute, a couple other museums that we're working with as well, are things like the Georgia O'Keeffe Museum. And basically what we're interested in here is also doing 3D imaging. The technical novelty here is not as great, but the value to the conservation community is very significant because they've never used any technique like this in any of the analysis that they do. The last thing I'll talk about is about this phase retrieval problem that we've just started to get interested in. And this is part of a sort of broader effort in my group to look at this specific image processing problem that has had a long history in mainly the optics world, has now gained some interest in the more theoretical mathematical foundations on the image processing side, and has some really interesting applications in biological imaging that have just emerged in the last couple decades. So I'm just going to give you a high-level overview of all of these projects with some technical details on the first and the last one. Okay, so I'll talk about MC3D, or motion contrast 3D scanning. And this is work that was done by my, all the technical part of this work was done by my PhD student, Nathan Matsuda, and also in collaboration with Mohit Gupta, who I think some of you guys probably saw give a talk here, also about active 3D scanning not too long ago. So, This is really the high level idea that we were going after. Okay, so the idea is to take a point scanning system like this. Okay, so we have a laser dot that's moving across our scene, And our goal is to capture information about the position of that dot as it scans across the scene. And the traditional way to do this would be to capture a sequence of photographs. And then that would be essentially equivalent to a point scanning, the information you would need to capture for a point scanning 3D laser scanner. And the issue there is really the amount of data that you need to capture. So if you have an image sensor that's n by n pixels, and you're scanning your point across each pixel in the scene, that's going to require m times n images. And the goal that we're going after here is that, you know, really the amount of information in the scene as we're projecting this dot through and moving it across the scene is actually really minimal. And what we want to do is figure out some way to extract from our sensor just the pertinent information about the location of the spot in the scene, and then essentially stack that up as a queue, a list of numbers, as a function of time as the point is scanned across the scene. And the goal there is that if you have some way to do that, then you can reduce it from m squared times n squared measurements to just m times n different pieces of data that your sensor has to capture and send through the system pipeline to the computer to do the 3D processing. That's the high level idea. And again, the goal is to do 3D capture. Okay, so the reason why we're looking at 3D scanning is that basically, this is sort of the way that I think about it. So broadly, we can categorize 3D capture techniques into the most basic ones are the passive ones, which are the stereo methods. Two cameras looking at different views of the scene with different amounts of parallax. When you look at the shift of different types of texture features, you're allowed to, you can compute the depth based on the baseline between the two different cameras. Very closely related to depth from focus or depth from defocus techniques, where you use depth-dependent blur to try to figure out where what the distance away from the scene is. So these passive techniques. So the idea here is that you know they can work well for scenes that have strong amounts of texture, but they really don't work if you have no high-frequency spatial information in the scene. So if you're trying to capture the depth of a wall, and you're capturing two images of the wall from slightly different perspectives, the images look the same because there's no texture on them. You can't calculate any parallax information. So that's why we look at active scanning systems. So active scanning systems essentially project texture in one form or another out into the scene that allows us to establish correspondences between, in this case, a projector projecting light and a camera capturing light. And so laser scanners are one form of active 3D acquisition systems, but they're part of essentially a broad class of structured light systems, where again, all of these techniques are based on triangulation. You have a camera that's displaced with some baseline to a projector, and the projector is projecting light out into the scene. For a laser scanner, the light pattern that's getting projected is just a dot that gets captured in sequence. For a system like the structured light system in the Kinect 1, a single pattern is projected, the image is captured by the camera, and then deformations of this pattern are used to determine parallax information, essentially trading off some sort of spatial resolution or smoothness assumptions for getting a 3D image in a single snapshot. Okay, so the triangulation-based structured light methods work on a different principle than the time-of-flight principle. Okay, so the time-of-flight principle would be like the latest Kinect 2 type of a sensor. The way that that works is that you temporally modulate the illumination from the source, and then you have some sort of demodulation that happens on the sensor, and you use that to figure out the time of travel from the illumination source to the detector back to the sensor, which then you can use to backtrack and calculate the depth of the scene. So for the rest of the talk, I'm not going to really talk about time of flight systems, because I'm going to focus on triangulation-based systems. And a high-level thing, comparison you can keep in mind about the systems is that for the temporal modulation systems, you need to have high modulation frequencies to get high depth resolution. And there are limitations both in terms of, really on the sensing side, in terms of the frequencies that you can use on your sensor and the depth resolution that you can get. The triangulation-based systems, the depth resolution depends on the baseline and the distance to the scene. And so in general, for closer scenes, you can do much higher depth resolution with a triangulation-based structured light system, whereas for a time-of-flight system, you can get very high resolution, depth resolution, even at really, really large distances away. So that's sort of like the way to compare these two different technologies. And so here's an example of being able to use triangulation-based structured light system, in this case a line stripe laser scanner, to get, you know, in this case I think they got sub-millimeter accuracy in the scan of, this was the digital Michelangelo project where they scanned Michelangelo's tablet. So you can get very, very high quality 3D scans with laser scanning. And that's what essentially we started out thinking about, is like we want to push towards this type of very high quality 3D scans as much as possible. Okay, so a taxonomy of structured light systems. Okay, so here I have sort of my classification of this sort of continuum between different types of structured light systems. So on the top left here, we have a laser scanning system. So we have a point being projected from our laser, a point or a line being projected from our laser that's being swept through the scene. We capture a sequence of photographs from our camera. And then we figure out what the disparity is, essentially the difference between the column that's projected out from the projector and the column that's received on the camera. And that gives us depth information that is scanned over time. And if we have, if we're doing point scanning and our resolution is MIN, we need to capture M times N images. If we're doing column scanning, then we need to capture M images, which could be significant, as much as like 1,000. So the way to make this faster is and remember, the key here is just establishing correspondence between the projector and the camera. You're essentially trying to find this triangle, sending a ray out from your projector, and then finding where that ray projects to in the camera. That's the whole goal. That correspondence is the key to calculating the depth, because once you know the geometric relationship between the camera and the projector, you can use that to calculate the depth. So there's other ways to capture, to get this correspondence information faster. And one of the ways is to use a binary coding scheme. Okay, and so the idea is you project a series of binary patterns with different spatial frequencies, and what they do is uniquely code each of the columns in the projector's frame of reference. So when you measure a bit pattern on your camera, on, off, whatever it is, you can uniquely figure out which code in the projector that column belongs to, and that establishes the correspondence, and then you can calculate the depth. And the advantage here is that you can use a divide and conquer approach, essentially getting a logarithmic time what here it would take you to do linear time in terms of the number of columns. You can add into the mix intensity modulation. So now you, in addition to, you basically assign a unique intensity identifier to each projected pattern. One of the examples is a phase shifting type of pattern where you project sinusoids. Other examples are a phase ramp, where you just project a gradient in intensity. And so, for instance, in the phase shift pattern, you can capture with this fuse, in principle, just three images. The phase ramp, you can just do two images. And basically, what we're seeing is, as we're moving in this direction, the ability to capture the images faster. And so in this here, I have the example of this, the first generation Kinect here, where we're just projecting a single image, and then we're using smoothness constraints to recover the depth. This is sort of the space of different types of structured light systems. On the left-hand corner for the laser scanning system, we have what is essentially a very slow system. However, for this system, the light is highly concentrated. Right, because you're only projecting all of your available light power, you're focusing to one point in the scene. And then for all of these systems, you're essentially flooding the scene with lots of illumination. And the advantage of that is that it's giving you a faster acquisition system. Okay, so this is a trade-off. Yeah?
About 10 years ago, somebody proposed a system. They used a diffraction grating to generate a sweep of wavelengths so that each wavelength one plane, then you can simply look at the color of each pixel in the scene and determine based on that, because it's monochromatic light at any one point, determine which plane you were looking at. Does anybody use that technique today?
What you're describing sounds like OCT. Is it used coherence gating?
No, it's just diffraction grating. It sends out a rainbow, basically.
Uh-huh.
But if you look at any one plane in that rainbow, the light is monochromatic. And so you can look at the ratio of the red, green, and blue responses that you get in your pixel, for any pixel that's being illuminated.
Yeah.
And you can immediately determine which monochromatic wavelength gave rise to that.
Yeah, I mean, that's basically related to phase shifting. It's you're using intensity coding, right? So whatever the intensity in the captured image is going to be a unique identifier for the column, which is going to allow you to establish a correspondence. In that case, it's just using color in addition to intensity.
Yes.
Yeah. So that would fall in sort of this category over here. So definitely. People do that. I don't know, commercially, I don't know of any system that's out there that does that. And I'm not sure exactly why that specifically doesn't exist in a commercial product, but it could, certainly. Okay, so the point that I was trying to get at here was this sort of trade-off between how fast you can capture the data and the way that you're using your light efficiently in the system. And the point there is that it has a really strong implication for some particularly challenging types of 3D scanning environments. So for instance, here's a comparison between laser scanning, line scanning in this case, and then gray codes. Okay? And so this was sort of the ideal scenario where you project light into the scene and the only light that exists in your universe is light coming from the camera. However, you know, in practice, there's always going to be some light just ambiently, you know, in the scene, coming from overhead lights, coming from bouncing off of the walls. If you're trying to go outdoors, that means you have to compete with light from the sun. Okay, so your model is that your only illumination source is your projector. In reality, that's not the case. Okay, and however, for our laser scanning system, okay, we're taking all of our available power and we're concentrating it to a small line. Yeah.
Is it okay if I switch off the light in the room? Because
yes. Yeah. Actually, that'd be great.
They're actually recording.
Okay.
Is that
okay?
Yeah, that's better.
That's great. Better contrast.
Thank you.
Okay, and so the goal here is to establish the correspondence, figure out which column in the projector projected this line. You want to figure out what it maps to the sensor. So you use some sort of binary thresholding or equivalent type of an algorithm and figure out, you know, the location of this line, and now you've established correspondence. It works fine in the absence of ambient illumination. If you add ambient illumination to the mix, provided you have sufficient optical power, and in this case, remember, you're taking all your optical power and you're concentrating it to a narrow line, you can just adjust your threshold and still get a good binarization. But the issue here is that when you switch over to a gray coding type of a scheme, which remember the whole motivation there was to make the scanning mechanism faster. So what you did is you floodlight the scene with illumination with this binary coding pattern. Now that you're conserving optical power, so the power that you used to project onto this line, you've now spread it over a larger area. And so as a result, of course, when you don't have when you have the ideal case, you're fine. You can get a good binarization, but when you add ambient light into the mix, you now have your ambient light being much stronger than certain areas in your scene, and you get, even if you adjust your thresholding, you still result in binarization errors that propagate to depth errors in the scene. Yeah?
There's an obvious fix for this, right? You're going to tell us what that is.
Go ahead.
I mean, you just take subsequent images and say, when is it above or below the average, right?
Yeah, so there's a lot of work in trying to make binary and related coding patterns be robust to ambient light. Yes, there's definitely, and in fact, I think Mohit talked about several of these techniques when he was here a couple weeks ago. I'm actually not going to get into too much detail about that, but you're right. There is, and that's an important point of comparison. And to date, we do not have exhaustive comparisons with those techniques. Hopefully you can sort of suspend your questions about that, and we can talk about it more offline. Okay, the first one was ambient light. The second closely related one is global illumination. And so the idea here is that we're looking at an object that is, in this case, we're looking at a book. It's like a wedge pattern. Our model is that light goes from our source, bounces off the object, and goes to the sensor. This is sort of a picture of what that would look like if that were true. This is a picture of what we actually see. Light goes and hits the object. It bounces around different places in the object and then comes to the sensor. This is just a reality of the way that light propagation works for conventional and coherent imaging systems. We run into the same sort of problem here, which, again, can be mitigated. And there's actually some very specific cases that you can illustrate where the technique will work for a laser scanning system. For the gray coding system, you have the same sort of problem where the light that bounces around the scene and eventually basically gets low-pass filtered and just looks like a constant offset that is closely related to the same problem that you get with ambient illumination. And again, this is a scene-dependent problem here. This problem exists for convex scenes where light's bouncing around, has the potential to bounce around multiple times before it gets to the sensor. If it was a concave object, vice versa, then it wouldn't be a problem. Okay. So this is basically the space that we were trying to chart out here, okay? And looking at 3D scanning systems this way. On one axis, we have acquisition speed. We like to be able to acquire 3D scans fast. We'd like to be able to do them at high resolution. And we'd also like to have our systems be light efficient, because the more light efficient it is, the more robust we can do our 3D scanning relative to essentially light pollution in the scene, okay? So a laser scanning system, we put some up over here on the upper left-hand side. It's very light efficient. It takes all the light power. It concentrates it to a small area. But it's slow, but it's high resolution. And then we can plot out our other systems. We get gray coding and phase shifting. Those are higher speed. We've essentially traded off speed here for light efficiency. Instead of concentrating the light to a small area, we're now spreading it across the scene. And then we can throw things like single shot methods like Connect out there. And we can also look in the literature and see how there are systems that essentially offer trade-offs between these different extremes. So Mohit had a paper where he was looking at essentially hybridization between a gray coding scheme and a laser scanning scheme. It was a scene-dependent trade-off parameter that sort of allows you to adjust between the two systems dynamically, trading off light efficiency and speed. And then there's also methods that are sort of hybridizations between single shot and gray coding, essentially looking at the motion in the scene and changing the patterns that are being projected depending on if there's motion or not. Okay, and so this is our sort of taxonomy of the space, and then this is where we're trying to get in this upper right-hand corner. So this is the idea. So the idea is to take this very old principle, actually, biologically inspired principle, which is to sense, instead of sensing intensity, optical intensity directly, sense motion contrast. So this is the comparison, the very high level idea. We have some source with time varying intensity. So we have photon fluxes that are changing as a function of time. For a traditional photosensor, that would get converted to current or time-varying voltage. And then this is all happening internally. This is, you know, essentially the photosensor on your pixel. And then that analog time-varying photocurrent would then get sampled at different points of time periodically using a digital analog converter. Okay, so the motion contrast sensor, the idea here is to take that same time-varying photon flux, converting it to a time-varying voltage in this case, and then in the analog form, electronically perform a temporal differentiation, and then have a thresholding mechanism that is looking around waiting for this temporal derivative to exceed some threshold, and when it does, you spit out some information. And so this system here is, by nature, an asynchronous sensing mechanism. So this one pulls for information even when you get, you know, no intensity here. This one only spits out information when the value exceeds some threshold. Okay, and so the idea here, this is a biologically inspired idea. So constant stimulus to photoreceptors in your retina produce no output. Okay, so the way that your photoreceptors in your retina send impulses to your visual cortex is by sensing changes in intensity over time. And this is enforced by, at least partially by microsaccades that are always causing the scene to scan. So a lot of times what you're seeing is edge information that gets mapped to temporal information, and then that gets differentiated by the internal circuitry in the photoreceptor. And it's a compression mechanism. So it's a way to take the 100 million photoreceptors in the retina and essentially compress it down to a million or so signals that get sent down the optic nerve. And it's the same idea here. So people have built sensors based on, yeah?
Would you get better signal-to-noise ratio if you had, say, a sinusoidally varying input and then you had a matched temporal filter as opposed to a differentiator?
That sounds plausible. Get a better signal-to-noise ratio. That's a good question. It's you have one signal and you're sensing that signal only. That sounds like the ideal way to sense that signal. Yeah. I know, I have to think about that some more. It's a good question. What you're getting at is a good point, is that we're playing around with time domain stuff. It ends up being very closely related to the time domain modulation of time of flight type of techniques. Although there is going to be no time of flight information in this. This is going to be a triangulation-based technique. But we're incorporating temporal information implicitly into the way that the sensor is designed. Basically there's a team at ETH Zurich, the sensing team there, that has played around with sensing architectures that are based on this motion contrast principle. And this is a picture of a high-level block diagram of the circuit. You have a logarithmic photoreceptor, so you have time-varying photon flux coming in that gets converted to a time-varying voltage that's proportional to the logarithm of the incoming flux. And then you have a temporal differentiator circuit, which takes this time-varying voltage and differentiates it. And then you have a thresholding mechanism that looks for when the time-varying voltage exceeds, the derivative of the time-varying voltage exceeds some threshold, that gets pulled asynchronously and sent out as events through the circuitry of the sensor, the readout circuitry of the sensor, I should say. So this circuit, this is one pixel, basically. There would be a whole bunch of these replicated in an array. And this is what the output of the sensor looks like. So the idea here is that this is intended to be a apples-to-apples comparison in terms of bandwidth. Okay, so the same number of bits per second are coming out of these two imaging systems. On the left, we have a conventional video camera. On the right, we have a motion contrast camera. And the point here is that on the left, we're using a lot of bandwidth to measure sensors that are not changing intensity very much. And on the right, any pixels that are not changing in intensity are not being sensed. And what we're doing instead is we're using that extra bandwidth to sense the motion at higher temporal resolution. So that's the motivation for using the sensor. And it's been used for things like high-speed tracking. There's actually some sort of like, there's sort of some surveillance type of stuff that they use it for. And then there's actually a lot of people in field biology, I guess, are interested in this because they can do, put a sensor out there to watch when a rabbit comes out of a hole, and it's not consuming any power until there is movement in the scene. That's the main advantage of it. So this is the idea. The idea is really, really simple. It's just take our laser scanning system, where we're basically, you know, scanning sequentially through each of the columns in the projector frame of reference, and then take that system and then send it to a motion contrast camera. Okay, that's it. And the point here is that what we're going to do now is we're going to scan this laser scanner fast. So we're going to do it at 60 frames per second, 60 hertz repetition rate. And so at that speed, we're going to basically assume that the motion in the scene is static, And so as a result, the only intensity changes in the scene are caused by the laser pointer increasing the reflectance at that point, going to the sensor, essentially produces a spike in the time-varying voltage that's produced by a pixel. That gets differentiated, thresholded, produces a single event that tells us the location of the laser scanner at that specific point in time. That gets sent as a single event that gets sequenced over time as the laser scanner moves position. And each of these events produces two pieces of information. One is the column that gets mapped to in the sensor, and the other is the time of arrival event occurred. And based on calibration between the timing of the projector and the timing of the camera, you can produce a conventional disparity map and then use the intrinsics of the pose and the baseline between the camera and projector to compute a 3D model. So that's the idea. And the real advantage in comparison to a conventional laser scanning system is basically this bandwidth utilization. So the idea here is, like, if we have a line scanner here, the amount of time that it takes to scan each line in the full scene would be equivalent to the amount of time that would take given a sensor with equivalent bandwidth, the same number of pixels per second that are being read by the sensor, would need to capture n different frames, where each frame is only capturing one column of essentially depth information. Most of the pixels in the scene correspond to essentially wasted bandwidth, pixel measurements that don't really correspond to what you're trying to sense in the scene at all. And so, so we can do the equivalent of laser scanning in real-time speed. That's the idea. So this is the prototype. So this is the DVS-128. This is that motion contrast focal plane array that I was talking about before. It's a commercial product, but it's sold in small quantities right now. There's essentially a startup company that's looking for applications for the sensor, and we approached them with this idea of building a 3D scanner based on it and built this prototype. The projector there, it's called a ShowX projector from Microvision. It has a MEMS 2D scanner and a laser. And basically what it does is the laser projects to the scanner, and then it projects out to a point in space, and then you intensity modulate the laser as you scan the MEMS scanner, and it produces an image using essentially just laser temporal intensity modulation synchronized to this 2D MEMS scanner. And it's a commercial product. It was produced relatively inexpensively. It was like a $300 Pico projector. For one reason or another, the product is not available anymore. I'm not sure where the technology from Microvision sits at this end. I've been told that there is a new company that's going to be commercializing it. We used that system for our prototype and have since switched to our own custom-built laser scanning system for various reasons. Here's a comparison. So here we're comparing against the Kinect 1, and the main thing here is that we're getting the same scan speed as the Kinect 1. They're both triangulation-based systems. That's really the reason we're doing the comparison here between those. Because the point here is, what sort of performance can you get out of, how do you maximize the performance for a triangulation-based system? That was the comparison we were trying to make here. And the point is that we can get laser scan quality, all things being equal in terms of resolution. This is, again, relatively low resolution for this prototype, 128 by 128 resolution. But we can certainly do better than Kinect 1 giving the same amount of time to produce a scan. And again, close to laser scan quality, even though we get orders of magnitude decrease in the amount of time it takes to produce a scan. So here's a real-time scan result. Just a person spinning a coin. In this sense, this is, again, 128 by 128 pixels at 30 frames per second. And the only processing done here is some 2D median filters to correct for essentially dropped pixels.
In the previous slide, were you like rotating the figure or something? Like how did you, because it's based on motion, right?
No. So it's based on motion in the sense that change in intensity over time. Okay, the way that we induce a change in intensity over time is projecting a laser spot out in the scene and moving it really fast. So that induces a change in reflectance brightness as a function of time that's sensed by the pixel, which is the information that we take advantage of. Not, we actually assume the object to be stationary over the duration of the scan.
What about multi-path issues? Like when you project something, it might have multiple bounces and it might exceed a threshold and you may get multiple points.
So you can show that as long as the portion of the light that's reflected back in the direction of the camera is greater than the amount of light reflected in some other direction, meaning that it's basically not a perfect mirror or not too specular, then you can get, you're guaranteed to be able to set a threshold that will work for the system. So, and I'll show you some examples of highly reflective objects, or one example. Yeah?
Just on the video you showed us, why didn't the table come out? Why was it only the hand and the coin?
Oh, I don't know. I'd have to ask Nathan about that. I'm not entirely sure. Here's an example of pinwheel in comparison to connect one, identical frame rates. The real advantage that we're pushing for with this is performance in ambient light, and what the hopeful application there is outdoors, basically, doing robust outdoor 3D active triangulation-based scanning. So here's an initial experiment. Connect one, again, comparison. Starting out 150 lux, which would be like this room, and then increasing the illumination to be up to 5,000 lux, which would be a cloudy day, probably. And we can obviously do better than the Connect one. So, and the take-home message here was that this was about the ambient light on the surface was about 10 times greater than the laser. So basically, you couldn't see the laser point in these images because the laser is so much dimmer than the ambient light, but still we're able to get a good 3D scan despite that. So this was our first generation. This was actually using visible frequencies, red light, without any color filtering. So actually the sensor, even though we're projecting narrow bandwidth illumination, we're not filtering that narrow bandwidth on the sensor, which we could use to essentially block a lot of the ambient light getting to the sensor. So that was our first generation. This is our second generation. In this system, we have our own custom-built laser scanner using galvanometers instead of using this, you know, really cheap, efficient implementation from Microvision that, unfortunately, at this point is difficult to get hardware from. And we, at this point, have switched over to infrared wavelengths, where ambient light sources tend to have lower intensity. And we have also used a color filter now to block all wavelengths within a narrow bandwidth, except for the ones that we're projecting out. Okay, so this is probably about as good as you can do. This would be similar to the tricks that, that are being played inside of the Kinect 1 and 2 systems to block out ambient light. And in this case, we're showing you, so this light bulb is on. On the surface of the light bulb is 50,000 lux, quite bright. It's the equivalent to about what typical reflectance of like a human face would be in direct sunlight about it at noon. It's about as bright as you can get outdoors. And we're doing in real time, we actually are getting you a 3D scan of this light bulb as the light's on. So we're projecting light, very dim, onto the surface of this light bulb. And we're actually, based on the light that we're projecting onto the bulb, able to compute this geometry despite how much light is coming from the bulb.
That's a fluorescent light, though. So it's not putting out a lot of IR at all?
This one actually is, this example here is visible in this case. So the next example I'll show you is infrared outdoors. So you're right. So that detail I glossed over. We started out doing this invisible. The only difference here, so this is still visible, this is 633, but we have a narrow bandwidth filter in front of it, and then the next one will be outdoors with switching over to infrared. Okay, so now we're in infrared. This is the system here. So this is outdoors, again, noon, on a sunny day. This surface is, the illumination on the surface is 80 kilolux. We're about 4 meters away here, and we're going to scan a person. And here's the comparison. Okay, so this is, so there's a field of view mismatch here between our 3D scanner and, in this case, we're actually comparing with the Kinect 2 because the Kinect 2 has much better ambient light rejection than the Kinect 1. There's a field of view mismatch, which is just really just a practical issue between what focal length we had to use for the sensor and the projector based on the scan angles of the specific scanning optics that we're using. But the point is that we're getting a high quality depth map here, even in this 80 kilolux ambient illumination, and we can see that we're clearly getting failing in the Kinect 2. So we can definitely do better than the Kinect 2. We're hoping we can engineer this even further. But this is where essentially the state of the art is for us right now. Yeah.
So am I right in interpreting that in the middle image, when you watch the video, when the person stops moving the hand and his hand is close to the camera, you can see how sharp the silhouette of the hand is.
Yeah.
Whereas when the hand is moving, you can see that it's noisy. I mean, the depth.
Yes.
Is there with the outlines.
Yes. Closed. Yeah.
Is this the assumption, the static scene?
I think this you are seeing essentially motion blur.
Motion blur. And
there.
Assumption.
It looks weird because the sensing mechanism is totally different than a conventional sensor, but it's the effect of motion during essentially single scan period. So here I think, I can't remember, this one was lower frame rate. I can't remember why the technical reasons that we had to go lower frame rate here, but I think it was 10 hertz. Yeah, you're right. I think that's right. That's right. We can't, there's the scan speed limitation with the galvanometers over the field of view that we want is just a trade-off that we're stuck with for this prototype. Here's a first stab at a comparison between doing a book, that V groove type of an object, where the light that you project is going to bounce around multiple times before it gets back to the sensor, and it produces serious depth errors for the gray coding system, and then we're able to at least more faithfully reconstruct the shape of that book V groove shape there. Here's another example of a highly reflective object, a metallic sphere, and again, we're able to get the sphere pretty faithfully, whereas a gray coding method fails. Yeah.
So you mentioned earlier that if the reflectance isn't a specular mirror,
yeah,
and you can choose a threshold that will give you the correct depth. Do you have an algorithm for choosing that dynamically, or do you have to tweak that by hand?
Right now, it's all by hand. So basically, right now, whenever we set up an experiment, we tune the parameters specifically for that experiment. So that's definitely next steps is flexibility in the sensor operation and algorithmic programming. That like none of this has to be hard coded. That like you're saying, it can operate on the fly to change to different conditions. Yeah, that's a good point. Wow. Okay. So I spent a lot of time on that. I'm supposed to end at 11:30, right? Okay. So I'm going to give you a really brief overview of these other two projects. So I think they're cool projects, and they give you a sense that we're really trying to work on a lot of different stuff. So the point here is there's all these prints at the Art Institute of Chicago that they don't know how they were made. Okay, and The reason is because basically, so there's this artist, Paul Gauguin. I believe some of his paintings have sold, or the most expensive paintings in the world at this point. We're looking at his prints, not his paintings. He has this whole other body of work that the process that he used is really not well understood. And so they, the Art Institute basically picked some prints that they wanted to study carefully. This is an example of one that we looked at closely. Nativity. This is the front of the print and the back of the print. This is essentially what was hypothesized as the printing process that was used. It's a standard monotype process. I'm not going to go over the details. But that hypothesis had some weaknesses. And the main reason is because when they looked closely at these prints, you could see what appeared to be these broken lines in the print. And so what they were basically interested in figuring out here is, do these broken lines originate from indentations in the print that were caused by him essentially tracing something on top of it, and then the surface pressure transferring from the top to the bottom, the way that you would, you know, transfer a secret message from the one top of a post-it to one below it, that sort of a thing. Blind incisings is what they called them. They thought that was the origin of these, and really were not sure what to do. And so I'm going to keep going here. They asked us to make some 3D surface measurements of the paintings to try to verify if this was the case. And so these are museum conservators, so they don't have access to anything high tech at all. They have access to cameras, they have access to lighting equipment, standard photographic equipment. So the approach that we chose to go with was photometric stereo, because that's something that they can actually implement in their lab there. So basically what that means is we're capturing a sequence of photographs of the scene from a fixed camera viewpoint and changing the illumination. And this is the data that we're capturing. So here's the painting. We're changing the light source around. From this ball, reflective ball here, you can figure out the angle of the light source coming in. And then based on the angle of the light source coming in and the brightness that you measure for each of those directions, you can back calculate, giving some basic assumptions or understanding about the material properties in the scene. You can compute 3D surface information and use that to essentially differentiate between surface color and get to underlying 3D surface shape. That's what they're interested in here. That's what we were helping them out with. And the answers that we're able to, there's two main questions that we were able to answer for them in this process. The first was the origination of these lines. So you can see as these lines are pulled away, you can see very clear surface perturbations, so hills coming out of the page. This is about 100 micron detail size that we're seeing the height of these perturbations. And that was essentially strong enough evidence for them to indicate that the transfer process was such that the print was placed down, pressure was applied to the back, which caused indentations on the front, which was the way the ink was transferred from an ink support surface to the print. Okay, and so that's the first piece of evidence we were able to get them. The second piece of evidence was that all of these locations where you looked like you had these broken lines, we were able to verify that despite the fact that we know we can measure accurate 3D surface shapes for these prints, there are no surface features that correspond to any of these broken lines. So that's what we were able to do for them. And what it allowed them to come away with is this idea that the way that he made these prints was he took ink surfaces that were tarnished to begin with. So this is basically the process that we were able to come up with for how he made these prints. Start off making a print, he's pushing on the back, ink is getting applied from the inked surface to the front of the piece of paper, and then you pull up the print and you move it away, and then this is now the beginning of the next print, which is the one that we were analyzing. Okay? So now we put a piece of paper down, we draw on the back, ink gets transferred from the ink surface to the front. However, now because the ink surface was tarnished, there were already ink lines that were removed, there are broken lines that appeared in the transferred ink, and then the process continues for one more ink layer, and this is the mock-up comparison between the front and the back, our reconstruction versus the ground truth, and they were very happy with this process. They thought that this was a pretty good explanation for the process that Gauguin most likely used. Okay, last one. I'll just do this quickly. Totally different flavor here. So this is actually about this project is about X-ray imaging. Although it's related to a lot of other problems, specifically what we're interested in is basically very high resolution X-ray imaging. So the idea here is that you're using X-rays that have a very, very small wavelength. And so as a result, you can resolve features on the order, when you have your imaging set up appropriately, features on the order of the wavelength, which can be as small as tens or even single nanometer resolutions for specifically what has been a really hot topic in the last couple of years is biological samples. So looking at biological samples, sub-cellular level, has been a new phenomena that has really occurred because of these very high power X-ray sources that have come out of these national labs that are repurposing now defunct physics experiments, particle accelerators, and using them as essentially high powered light sources that anyone can apply to use for their experiments. That's where a lot of biology experiments are now flocking to these national instruments to use these high powered X-ray sources. And the issue here, so biological imaging is one of the great things. So the issue here is that the way these experiments work, you can't bend around X-rays the way that you can optical frequencies. So you can't, it's hard to build a lens, it's expensive to build a lens, it's possible to build a lens, it has to be diffractive. You can't make things refracted X-ray. Building reflective optics is expensive in X-rays. The easiest by far way to do it is you just shine light onto your object. That light, remember this is very, very small wavelength light, it diffracts, and the diffraction pattern, you just go directly to a sensor. That's the whole model. That's the whole, it's completely lensless. Send light to the sensor, it scatters, you measure the intensity, okay? And the problem is that with these systems is that most of the light doesn't get scattered. So you have this large concentration of light at the center of the beam, and you get a dynamic range problem. And this is because these are essentially natural images here. And natural images we know are very sharply peaked in the center in the low frequency region, and that's what's happening, and typically have a very, very large dynamic range. And we're sensing the amplitude pattern of the Fourier transform of this image here. That's what we're trying to do here. And it's problematic. And it produces all sorts of issues with the sensor. What's typically done is actually they just, to avoid blooming problems with the sensors, they just block out. They put literally a physical absorber block in the center of the sensor. Just don't sense that light at all. And so one solution is to do HDR, just as we all know, capture multiple images with different exposures. This is done, but it's slow. And there are certainly applications where they would like to do this faster and not have to wait around to capture multiple exposures to make it work. So single shot imaging, you put an X-ray beam on your object, it scatters, you essentially measure the amplitude of the Fourier transform, it has a very large dynamic range, so you throw away the center. That was the problem that we're looking at here. And I'll just skip ahead to the results. So the point is, how can I distill this point in 3 minutes? Okay. So I'll walk through briefly. It'll just be slightly more than 3 minutes. Okay. Good. So I'll explain it properly. So this is the model. The model is that our sensing model is we take our image of our specimen X, we scatter it. If the scattering is far enough away, it essentially boils down to taking a Fourier transform. And that Fourier transform, we actually only measure the modulus of that Fourier transform. But given some special tricks we can play, if we just take the inverse Fourier transform, we can get the object back. Okay. There's a caveat here is that we need the phase in the Fourier transform, which we're not measuring. But there's tricks that you can play with that. And so the difference here is that we're just going to have a high pass filter here. And the point is that we're blocking all the DC frequencies. So if we do just naive inverse Fourier transform processing, it's equivalent to taking our image and applying a high pass filter to it. So all we're doing here is we're just applying some regularization to this problem. And this is a very simple solution, obvious to anybody who's done some image processing or played around with some sort of computational photography tricks. It just happens to be something that hasn't been looked at in this X-ray community, which is basically mostly physics stuff. So we're using a total variation regularization to solve for this problem here. This is sort of the experimental setup. So the way that this is done, so this is the experimental setup. You have your object here, so here we're represented by Lena's eye, okay? And then you have a couple dots out here. And the idea is that you measure the intensity in the Fourier plane, okay? Actually, the squared magnitude, okay? And then that's equivalent to, if you took its inverse Fourier transform, that'd be equivalent to taking this image and measuring its autocorrelation, okay? And so when you look at its autocorrelation, the autocorrelation looks like this. And the point is that because you had a couple of dots out here, the autocorrelation is going to give you copies of the image that you carry about out here. That's the basic idea for how to solve this problem of you're only measuring intensity out here, even though you don't have the phase, you're able to sort of get the equivalent of getting the phase back just using simple Fourier transform, inverse Fourier transform, that sort of thing. But it doesn't work when you have missing data, okay? So it just totally fails when you essentially just apply a high pass filter to that other image that we captured. You don't get a good reconstruction. However, if you regularize, then you do get a good reconstruction for the natural images. This part in the center is essentially the autocorrelation of this image. You can't reconstruct that well because it doesn't obey statistics of natural images, but you don't care. All you care about is getting these images out here correct, the copies. And it seems to work very well for at least the initial experiments that we've done. This is a real experiment in visible comparison between a conventional reconstruction and a regularized reconstruction, just very basic images at this point. We're now working with some physicists at the Argonne National Laboratory to get real biological data to test this out on. There's some comparisons that you can make to, you know, different types of biological specimens, resolution targets. This would be a typical result that they would get out of their algorithms, and then this is where we're able to push their results using a simple twist on the algorithmic processing. So that's it. So that's just the flavor of the projects that we work on. The MC3D scanning system, doing high-quality, active triangulation-based 3D scanning outdoors is where we're trying to push it. We have a lot of collaborations with cultural heritage institutions, Art Institute of Chicago, other universities around the world, where we're trying to do imaging, computational imaging, 3D imaging, and take it into interesting places, specifically inexpensive implementations is what we're interested in this area of things. And then we're also interested in these emerging imaging applications in different scientific fields.
Any more questions for our speaker?
So for your the last thing where you had the two dots in the side on either corner there, is that effectively like making something like a hologram?
It's exactly a hologram. It's called Fourier transform holography.
Okay, but you had two reference sources, which is interesting.
Yeah, it doesn't have to be that way. Basically, people played around with all sorts of different types of reference objects. So like even using multiple points together, or one interesting implication is it's basically boils down to contrast in the interference between the light diffracted from the point source and the light diffracted from the object. You want more light because you can't put a beam splitter in the setup to make more light go through the pinhole. So ideally you'd like to not attenuate as much light and, for instance, just use a circular aperture, and that's square aperture has been done before. Because basically, if you apply two derivatives in each of, in horizontal and then vertical, you end up with four delta functions at the corners. And so you can get higher contrast fringes and then get back to the same image that you would have had if you had two dots, that sort of a thing. What I didn't really get a chance to do is that in practice, this is just one of the techniques that they use is holography. What they really like to do is no interference at all. Like just take the diffraction pattern from the object and just measure the amplitude of its Fourier transform. And there's a series of these sort of so-called iterative, non-deterministic phase retrieval techniques that are used in that case, which the technique that we came up with, it also works in that case too. It's called coherent diffraction imaging. And that is the more common way to actually solve this problem rather than, because the alternative is like you actually have to make a piece of hardware that has little dots in it, and then you need to stick your object with a known position relative to those little dots. And this is nanometer scale, tens of nanometers. So it can be really challenging. And so taking the pinholes out of the equation essentially makes for similar experimental setups, easier to, more convenient experimental setups. And that's the regime that it's more often used in.
Is that hard to just get two beams coming from different directions, for example, instead?
Yeah. It's a pain in the butt. I think any type of optical components for the X-ray are really a pain in the butt to work with. I think that's my understanding of the situation. Like beam splitters, focusing optics, all these things, they do exist and people use them. But they seriously add to the complication of the experimental setup. So if they can avoid using it, they like to.
Any other questions? I just have one.
So, yep.
How do you know that the results of your form exterior is reasonably accurate, given that A, the surface is not really Lambertian, and B, there's a lot of concavities that cause you to win and so on?
So that's basically what we're looking at now. So the goal right now is to actually take ground truth measurements using high precision 3D surface measurement equipment. So we're going to take a white light interferometer, measure to micron scale the height maps of a set of representative surfaces that have been produced by the conservators that have reflectances similar to what the materials in the actual artworks that we care about, make ground truth measurements, do comparisons between different photometric stereo reconstruction algorithms, different assumptions about what, using libraries of materials, BRDF libraries, that sort of a thing. That's essentially what we're looking at now. For this initial work, all we did was we just assumed it's Lambertian, and the results were informative to them. Even that simple assumption, straight photometric stereo from 1980, Woodward paper, that's all we were doing. But that was useful to them. Now we're starting to look at it in a little bit more detail to see how important it is to have, to be, what level of accuracy is really required out of these things.
Yeah. Well, let's thank the speaker once more.